Today marks the day where we can talk about, to a certain degree, the new AMD Radeon 7900 series graphics cards. But before we get into that, here's a quick word from this video sponsor. Hello mate, you all right? Yeah, just got all the bits for my banging new gaming PC. Just got to put it together. It's going to be so much better than yours. Oh, right. What did you get then? The latest Intel 12th gen processor, a feature-packed motherboard, and 32 gig of DDR4 memory. See? Miles ahead of yours. You realise that board needs DDR5 memory, don't you? Don't tell me you went and bought the wrong stuff. DDR4 is so 2014. I can't believe you was that stupid. What? No, you're joking. What should I get then? For me, I'd be looking at Corsair's newest Vengeance DDR5 kits. Or, if you're wanting that all-important RGB, then go for the Dominator Platinum RGB. Oh, you are a lifesaver. Thanks, but where can I find out more? By clicking the link in the description below, of course. And you call me the stupid one. So whenever a graphics card launches, there always seems to be different ways of doing it, whether that be launching everything at the same time or having different NDAs specific to different things that we can talk about, whether it be unboxing the cards, doing previews, and then obviously talking about performance at a slightly later date. Sometimes we also get cards that are reference based, like we have here with the 7900 XT and the 7900 XTX. Then we do also have AIB cards, which we can talk about at a later date as well. So definitely expect lots of content based around performance on these cards, as well as AIB cards as well. Now, when it comes to these cards, when they were announced, we did have some content on that that kind of went through, you know, the main specs, what we could potentially expect. So today, really, I want to focus on the cards themselves and kind of how they look, the style of them, the unboxing experience, that kind of stuff. So we do have the 7900 XT and the 7900 XTX, which are both coming in, I guess you could say, significantly cheaper than Nvidia's counterparts, with $899 for the 7900 XT and $999 for the XTX, which does undercut the RTX 4080 by a margin and does undercut the RTX 4090 by, frankly, a lot. Now, obviously, there has been talk about the likes of the RTX 4080 potentially going down in price. And if you actually check out Nvidia's website, it has decreased ever so slightly, at least in the UK, by £69 on the RTX 4080. So I think maybe that's something to do with these cards coming out and not Nvidia being scared as such, but just reading the market a little bit better, which you could argue when those cards launched, they didn't read the market at all. Now, let's talk about the 7900 XT and then we'll get onto the XTX. So the 7900 XT and the XTX are both, I guess, roundabout way of saying it, they're claiming from AMD that is the most advanced graphics for gamers and creators. Now they probably are referring more to the XTX, but you'd like to think, being based on the same RDNA 3 kind of architecture, the 7900 XT is going to be very, very similar in terms of what it's able to deliver, just less performance on the XT compared to the XTX. Now, one cool thing about these is they've kind of taken a different approach to it, now incorporating the first chiplet design, which is very similar to the Ryzen processors that we've seen from AMD. Now, the reason they've done this is kind of, from my perspective, different ways of delivering a product. So by having a chiplet design, it does mean that they actually have a 5 nanometer GCD or graphics compute die, and then 6 nanometer memory cache dies or MCDs. Now, what this actually means is that in theory, there should be higher yields on this compared to Nvidia with their 4N process node. Again, in theory, and so much of this video is going to come down to, I guess, speculative data, that by having a 5 nanometer and 6 nanometer process node to work from, they should have higher yields, which does mean stock should be a lot more plentiful. And as we know, and as we've seen over the years, if stock isn't a problem, then pricing shouldn't be a problem. So it's going to be interesting to see if AMD actually do have a good amount of stock, especially in comparison to Nvidia. Now, we do have 84 and 96 compute units and then the same for ray accelerators, and we have up to 2300 megahertz on the game frequency. So let's talk about the 7900 XT and kind of what you get. Now, in terms of the boxes, they both look pretty identical. They're sort of the same thickness, the same, basically the box is exactly the same apart from one says XT and one says XTX. So there's not really too much to talk about other than you get your kind of first glimpse of the design. Now, these are AMD reference cards. You are going to be able to buy them from certain retailers as well as from AMD's own webshop on AMD.com. Now, when you actually open this up, they do differ slightly when you open the boxes, with the XT sort of opening up and giving you your first glimpse of the card. It does say, AMD, welcome to the Red Team, the new standard of high performance gaming. That's about kind of all there really is to talk about in terms of the box. Obviously, we do have the card in here, which I'll take out so you can see exactly what it's about. Other than that, there's no kind of added accessories. You do get this little sort of compartment under here, and inside is just some literature. So AMD Red Team, and it has a little QR code on there saying The Conversation, which takes you to community.amd.com, and then another QR code for more information, please visit amd.com/Radeon user manual. Though how much information you really need for that is anyone's guess. So that's about it. So you will actually be, you know, greeted with nothing else other than that, unlike Nvidia cards, which had to come with a new adapter. Now, that's a very big thing, because we all know the trials and tribulations that Nvidia have had with their 12+4, if you want to call it that, or the 16 pin, however you want to word it. But they have had a lot of negative press. There is still findings going on with that, and we don't really know the full ins and outs other than what it seems to be at the moment, and the key word here is seems to be, is that it is down to user error and people not actually plugging in the connector properly. AMD have completely eliminated that by just keeping the bog standard 8-pin connectors, which is more than enough, because these cards do actually have less power delivery as total board power, which is kind of why they don't have to go down the route of having these connectors that can power up to 600 watts. So this is the card. It looks pretty interesting. I mean, it is a step up from the last generation of cards, so the 6900 XT, 6800 XT, 6800. They've just made things, I guess, a little bit more refined, and that really does show in the build quality and the general design of the card. It does have essentially a full kind of stealthy black design. There is a little bit of red because it is AMD, so you've got these kind of lines here, and then on the back plate there's a couple of little bits of red as well. What is interesting is that they've got rid of basically any unnecessary text, which would normally be on either the back of the card or a little sticker on the PCB either here or down on the finger down here, and instead they've actually put it round the end of the card, which I've got to admit, when I first saw it I was like, that looks, well, frankly goddamn awful. But I get it, because you're not actually going to see this when this is inside your case. So it has got a very, very large heatsink on there, triple fan design, and I want to put it out there to you guys. What do we think about the kind of middle of the fan? Some people are saying it looks a bit like Predator, which I do get. I personally think it looks a little bit like a praying mantis. Whether that's intentional or whether it's just, you know, a design choice that turned into potentially a happy accident, I guess the only people who really know about that is AMD. Now, with both cards, they do things slightly differently in terms of the way that the memory and the GPU core actually interact with each other to paint the big picture. So we do have 80 megabytes of Infinity Cache on here, and then 96 megabytes on the XTX. There are a few other kind of cool features that both cards have, and I will get to that as we go through. But talking about the design, triple fan, one interesting thing there actually is the fact that all of the fans spin the same way, which is, in my opinion, very interesting, because normally when it comes to AIB cards, we've actually seen, I guess over the last generation or so on both AMD and Nvidia, the outer fan spinning a different way to kind of reduce turbulence and things like that. Card wise, 2.5 slots, and that's exactly the same for the XTX as well, though the XTX is ever so slightly taller. I will get sort of through, you know, information on how long they are and things like that as well. You have a very simple but quite sturdy and strong backplate on there, which does kind of mold round to the front, and there's nothing really out of the ordinary. It just looks really simple, really kind of well built, and just generally a nice looking card. They haven't gone too over the top, they haven't gone too fancy. It's just nice and simple. There is a little Radeon logo on here as well, and we will overlay some B-roll shots so you can see exactly how this looks when it's powered up as well. Now, in terms of power delivery, there are two 8-pin connectors on here, so we have actually got a total board power of 300 watts, which is a lot less than the RTX 4080, and especially a lot less than the RTX 4090. What that means for performance, I can't talk about yet. So we will get to that when we can unveil the performance results in the next couple of days, because I think there's going to be a lot of people out there who are maybe trying to gauge what the performance is going to be like based on the total board power. Because you'd like to think, if it has got more power, it's then going to deliver more performance. Also, by being a 300 watt base card, it does mean that minimum power supply requirement wise, AMD actually recommend 750 watts. Now, this card itself does actually come in at 276 millimeters, which again, compared to the competition, is a lot less. We have seen a lot of 4080s sharing exactly the same cooler as the 4090, which can come in anywhere up to about 334 millimeters long. So what I'm trying to say is, you're probably not gonna have any problems putting this inside your case. Now, when it comes to the rear I/O, things do change up ever so slightly. So we do have HDMI, DisplayPort, another DisplayPort, and a USB Type-C. And the cool thing about the DisplayPort, obviously HDMI is HDMI 2.1, but we do now have DisplayPort 2.1, compared to Nvidia, who only actually have DisplayPort 1.4a. What that actually means is AMD, in theory, and if the performance is there, obviously, can power up to 8K 165Hz. Whether it can in games is anyone's guess, but for someone who's doing productivity-based kind of tasks like we do, filming in 12K, because we are complete overkill for YouTube, but we do use a Blackmagic 12K camera for all of our videos, does mean that we can edit and just have a lot more sort of information on the screen. Now, talking about editing, content creation, and things like that, we do also have the ability for AV1 encoding and decoding at 8K 60, which is interesting, and I guess now it just paves the way that software applications from the likes of Adobe or Blackmagic Design with DaVinci Resolve and OBS Streamlabs and things like that really now need to, I guess, work with the technology that they've been given through the hardware to make the software kind of compatible and give us that flexibility to be able to use features like AV1 and decoding 8K 60. So let's talk about the 7900 XTX, because I kind of feel like, even though this is going to appeal to a lot of people, let's say more on the budget conscious side of things, this is actually, I guess, the card that most people are gonna wanna go for, because I kind of feel like, you know, RTX 3080 was such a huge deal. RTX 4080 should have been, but yeah, it was just too expensive for what it was. So this is, I guess, your next option. So 7900 XTX, again, the box looks very, very similar. You get the kind of first view of the card, which does look ever so slightly different compared to this one. So how are things actually going to differ in terms of performance? Again, we can tell you in a couple of days. Now, I'm all about the unboxing experience. I love it when kind of a card, a motherboard, anything gives you something to sort of go, wow. I remember over the years we've had Intel Nooks where you open it up and it does the dun 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 Intel kind of sound and stuff like that. This doesn't go quite that far, but it does do something quite cool. So when you open this up, it's actually on a hinge that when you get to about here, you will notice it props the card up, which I've got to admit, on our shelves would look absolutely amazing. So when we're not kind of using this card for extra benchmarking and things like that, maybe we could have it on the shelves like that. And then when you close it down, you can see the card sort of goes up and down. It's actually on a weird kind of lever that kind of pushes it up. So let's take that card out, and it's exactly the same. You can see the sort of mechanism here. When I open and close it, it goes up and down. Now, in here we get exactly the same. So the two little bits of kind of literature, I guess, which really are just QR codes. I feel that they could have maybe just put them on the box instead of having it in there, just to save on wastage and things like that. But yeah, generally speaking, quite nice. So the card itself, it does look very, very similar. You can see some similarities, I guess, but the Radeon logo is now on the front instead of on the top, so ever so slightly different. I did mention that it's, I guess, slightly taller. You can see if I put it in front, it does kind of block it. If I put it behind this one, you will see that kind of extra height to it. So there's a little bit in it, but it still is a 2.5 slot card. So no kind of real worries if you have got a slightly smaller case. And in terms of length, it is a little bit longer. Instead of 276 millimeters on this one, it's now 287 millimeters. It does also have, both of the cards, GDDR6, which does mean that the power requirements are a little bit less as well, because GDDR6X does require a little bit more power. What that means is that this card is 355 watts as a total board power, or TBP, and the minimum PSU requirement is 800 watts. So not a great deal within it. Now, because it does have such a, I guess, low power supply requirement compared to obviously the competition, it does still, again, only have the two 8-pin connectors. Very simple backplate look. it's basically identical to the 7900 XT, so a real kind of step up, I guess, on the general overall design. There's again a little bit of red here and then on the back plate, but overall just a nice looking card, and it's got a decent amount of weight to it. And in our kind of, you know, future content, we will actually look at the weight, the dimensions. We will be tearing it down as well, because I guess I can get away with saying this, there is some interesting stuff under the hood, but I think that's about as far as I can push it today without getting in trouble due to NDAs. Now, in terms of performance, I can't talk about performance today other than what AMD have already claimed, which if you go onto their sort of product page for these cards, you will see that they are claiming some pretty bold performance claims. And those performance claims really come down to, you know, some of the top games out there. They are claiming everything is at 4K max settings, and we have 139 FPS in COD Modern Warfare 2, 98 frames per second in God of War, 93 in Red Dead Redemption 2, 109 frames per second in Assassin's Creed Valhalla, 138 FPS in Resident Evil Village with ray tracing turned on, 135 FPS in Doom Eternal with ray tracing on. But there is a really, really key point here. There is no mention of any form of upscaling. So has it got FSR? Are there some other settings on there? Or is it such a simple thing that they are using for their own kind of internal testing data? Both of these cards tested on AMD hardware. What I mean by that is an AMD GPU paired with an AMD CPU, which in theory, through the likes of smart access memory, should actually gain extra performance. Luckily, we test all of our graphics cards on a 12900K, so you'd like to think that the results that we're actually gonna give to you guys in a couple of days, so make sure you're subscribed for that, is going to be very reminiscent of kind of untweaked performance, so no smoke or mirrors or anything like that. So it is gonna be an interesting one to kind of look at. So that's about it. We have the 7900 XTX and the 7900 XT. I'm always a fan of doing unboxings just to kind of get you guys excited about what's to come in the next couple of days when it comes to performance, but it does always leave me at the end of the video sort of sitting there going, I want to say more. I know I can't say more, but what can I kind of drip feed to you and I guess get away with? But there really is nothing. Until we see them performance results, that's what's going to be, I guess, the pivotal point that's going to decide whether you're going to stick with Nvidia, whether you're going to stick with the graphics card you've already got, whether it be AMD or Nvidia, or if you're actually going to move up to one of these cards. All I can say is that AMD doesn't need to beat Nvidia right now. I think there's so many people out there who are annoyed and frustrated by Nvidia from the 30 series debacle that went on there with stock and things like that, and prices going through the roof, scalpers and everything, that there are going to be a selection of consumers who are going to move from Nvidia to AMD. There's going to be people who want to upgrade to AMD. There's going to be people who want to see ray tracing performance get better, but I don't think they're likely to be expecting it to be better than Nvidia, especially when it comes to the RTX 4090, which frankly was absolutely just amazing. Especially when you look at the likes of Portal RTX, which really is the new crisis. And we have got a video on that, so definitely go and check that out. So yeah, let me know, what do you think AMD need to do? Do they need to be better, or do they just need to be comparable because it is cheaper? Or are you willing to have a little less kind of performance because you are getting that saving in the costs? I'm really interested to know what you guys think. Let me know in the comments section below. And there you have it. Hopefully you enjoyed this video. If you did, a like and a sub to the channel would be amazing. And if you love what we do, consider supporting us over on Patreon, where you get access to a whole host of goodies, including behind the scenes content, exclusive game nights that we do on Discord every 2 weeks, as well as all of the testing data for these cards when we can lift the lid on it, which, like I say, is in a couple of days. So make sure you're subscribed for that. Until next video, thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you then. Cheers, guys. Bye bye.